very quickly, remember this time we talked about Tola, right? And we talked about the other judge, what's his name? Jair. Tola and Jair. So Tola, as you said, the Bible says that he judged for 23 years. Tola, by the way, the meaning of Tola, has anybody read about this? Tola is the Hebrew word for a worm. A worm. And a worm means it is a little worm. And he was a humble man. It goes with that in time. Also, Jesus Christ was very, very humble. I wonder how humble you are in your workplace and your home. Humbleness is an important Christian character. Tola, this Tola, the Bible says that he judged for 23 years. Jair, on the other hand, means light or shining, another character of Christ, because these judges all pointed to Christ, the deliverer or the actual savior. And he, the Bible says, this man Jair had 30 sons. And these 30 sons rode 30 donkeys. Did you read about that?
Yeah.
And they controlled 30 cities. So 30 sons with 30 donkeys and 30 cities. It looks like this man really cared about his children's well-being, right? They rode over donkeys, but it doesn't really talk about how he taught them spiritually. A lesson for you and me to be very careful also to give our children, beside their social status and their financial status, and to make them strong and willing to go, beside that is to also teach them something godly and Christian. At the end of today's lecture, we'll also talk about these verses to get them off the way. Ibzan. Ibzan is another judge that we know very little about. The name Ibzan means shining, just like the other one. So again, a symbol of Christ, and he judged Israel, the Bible says here, for 7 years. He too had 30 sons and 30 daughters, and then he went and had his sons get married outside his clan. And he had husbands for his daughters from outside his clan. He wanted to improve and to greaten his territory. That's all we know about him. This guy, this man. Another judge, as you can see here, Elon. Elon means power, and he was a powerful man. And he judged Israel for 10 years or not, but not least this guy, Abdon. And Abdon means worship. A judge who worshiped God. All are characters of a good Christian man. The cycle that we talked about. This four-point cycle, you know. The people are sin against God, and God afflicts them, then they cry out to God, and then God raises them a judge. The meat is these coming slides, the meat of the day. Well, there's a lot of writing, but I underline what I wanted to talk to you about today. The Israelites did evil in the eyes of God, and they worshipped the idols. As you can see there, this man is standing and worshipping the idols. And the Bible gives us a list of the idols. The gods of Aaron, the gods of Sidon, Moab, all these kind of gods. Verse 7, as you can see there, our God became angry with them, and he sold them. He sold them. That's a very difficult expression. When God sells you out because of your sinful life, he sold them into the hands of the Philistines. And look what they did to them. They crushed them, the expressions of the Bible, and shattered them. That's how Satan deals with it. If you deliver yourself into the hand of Satan, he will crush you and shatter you. And then the Israelites, in verse 10, as you can see there, they said to God, "We have sinned against you." And God knew that this was going to happen. God knew. It is not a surprise to God. Do you recall the times of Moses? Do you recall the times of Moses that God told Moses back in Deuteronomy, as you see on the screen? He told them that my people will prostitute themselves to foreign gods. This was about 500 years before. And they will forsake me, and I'm going to punish them. It may be that one of us today is going through some reprimandation by God. And I always say that God punishes the people who sin, but disciplines his children. God doesn't punish us, God disciplines us. You, who is listening, you are being disciplined by God. Never think that it is punishment. The Bible teaches this. God disciplines the people he loves. So it doesn't mean that God is angry with you. It just means that he's trying to discipline you. And quickly, God responded to them and he said, yes, when the Egyptians, and he goes on to tell them, but finally, I'm going to save you. I just want you to go quickly today. Just focus on the last slide. Let them save you when you are in trouble. Next. The Israelites said to God, yes, we have sinned, so do with us what you think is best. That's a sign of true repentance. You know, when someone comes to God and says, I am wrong, I am to take the blame. God, I agree. You are right, I am wrong. Do with me what you think is necessary. And to show a sign of repentance, my beloved, look what they did. They got rid of the foreign gods and they served God. Repentance means doing something. You can't just say, I repented, and you stay where you are. The repentance means that you've done something. True repentance is such. And when they really repented, those stiff-necked, hard-headed, stone-hearted people who were sinning all the time, just like you and me, just like me and you, just like you and me, and just like me and you, we're very much the same. But when we repent before God, truly, truly bow down before him, look what's written in red. God could bear their misery no longer. If anything you remember of today's lecture, remember this verse. That our God is a compassionate God. People are looking for compassion. In today's world, everyone is crushed. Everyone is tired. People are looking to be loved and to be cared for by someone. And here he is, stretching out his hands on the cross to the whole world and saying, I can bear your misery no longer. That's the God we worship. That's the God I follow. That's the God I teach my children to follow. Our God is compassionate. In the book of Psalms it says, the Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. I ask you, you who are listening to me today, does that also talk about you? Are you gracious and compassionate? Are you slow to anger? Are you rich in love to the people around you? You know, when God said in the Song of Songs, when he said, turn your eyes from me, for they overwhelm me. Really, a repentant eye, an eye that has tears, an eye that knows that it is sinful before God. God will be overwhelmed with such eye. Yes, we come to today's meat of this lecture. This man, Jephthah, by the way, means in Hebrew and also in Arabic language, it means open, muftah or yuftah or open. And he is also a symbol of the deliverer Christ, who also can open and no one can close. And he can close and no one can open. I don't know what your problem is today, but it is important to remember that God is sending someone a message today. Yes, this problem that you are going in, I can open and I can take care of you. When he opens, no one can shut. This guy, Jephthah, although we learned in the back room that he sinned and made a stupid vow and maybe his daughter was burned as a sacrifice, you will be shocked to see when you open the book of Hebrews that his name is listed. His name is listed with Samson and with King David and with Gideon. This guy Jephthah is an important man. And yes, when we go up to paradise, to heaven, he will be there. so I want to be very careful what I say about him. Jephthah, the Bible says, was a mighty warrior. As you can see, he was a strong man with muscles, with good strong body. He was a powerful guy. And simply because his mother was a sinful woman, a prostitute, his brothers kicked him out of the house. They kicked him out. They told him, no, your mother is different from ours. Your mother was a sinner, and so you don't deserve to live with us. Get out. And they fought with him, and they kicked him out, as you can see. Many times you and I do the same thing. We do wrong to people who, for some reason, there's nothing to blame this guy. Was it his sin? Was he married to a prostitute? Did he practice prostitution? Was he in a sexual conflict? He was not. It was his mother and father. The book, write that down or remember this number, Ezekiel 18, where God talks about sins of the parents and the children. And there's a lot of discussion. Many times today, people think they're going through difficulties because of what their mom did. Many young men today, they carry the guilt of what their father did. But no, the Bible teaches that no, if a parent sins, then the blood is on his head, not on that son. Not the other way around. And so they were very wrong to kick him out. And yes, they did. Look at them. They just told him, you go out. And when he got out, the result was he was surrounded by a group of adventurers, bad people. Never kick your son or daughter out of your home. Never kick a young man or woman out of the class at Sunday school. Don't ever do it. You will be surprised how Satan is waiting outside to snatch at them. In any way, he left. And I wanted you to show you from this map, if you can see where Gilead is, you can see where the land of Gilead there. But he left, and he went all the way up there to Tola. You see that little red city up there? Tola. And he lived there. But such is life. Fairness comes to them. The elders of Gilead come to him, they go to Tob and they call it, please be our deliverer. And he accepts. He accepts. He accepts. If I was Jephthah, really, and my brothers who kicked me out came to me and say, come and help me, I'll say, no. Well, now you want to come here, need to come and help you? I will never come and go. I will not do it. But this is the human nature in me. This is the flesh in me. But Jephthah was a good guy. And the fact that he helped his brothers despite what they did to him. And then he settles this dispute with the Ammonites. He didn't go to war right away with them. If you've read your chapter well, you'll see that he tried to talk peacefully to them. He spoke peacefully first. He tried to be peaceful. And he went in great length to tell the people of Ammon the history of the land. How did he know all this history? Because he knew his Torah. He knew the words of the Bible very, very well. And he was able to articulate to the Ammonite king, and he told them, no, this land originally belonged to such and such, and then this people came, and that people, he knew his Bible well. It is a lesson for all of us to also know our Bible very well, something we've spoken about a lot. Here you can see in this picture, as you've read it very clearly, that the Spirit of God comes on him. And he prays and God's Spirit comes on him. He attacks the Ammonites, as you can see, and the Bible tells us that he defeats them. But just before that, before God gave them the Ammonites, he makes a vow. And the vow was a hard vow. Said to God, oh, the Bible tells me, Jephthah made a vow to God, if you you give my enemy to my hands, whatever comes out of the door of my house to meet me, whatever comes out of the door of my house. This could be a man or a woman, a family member or a slave, young or old, an animal or a human, anything, whatever comes out to meet me, when I return in triumph, I will sacrifice as a burnt sacrifice. And lo and behold, he comes back, and who sees him? His daughter. And he is shocked. He is in terrible agony and pain. When he saw her, the Bible says, he tore his clothes and he cried out, "Oh, my daughter, you have made me miserable and wretched because I have made a vow to God that I cannot break." He also was a godly man. He said that if he has done a vow, he cannot break it. And we all know what happened. Jephthah's daughter, who later, through readings, I've learned that her name is Abna. She was a fantastic woman. Look what she said to her father. What would you say to your father if your father said, "You know, I've given a vow to kill you, to burn you to my God"? What is it? Get out, I'm running away, I'm taking my car and I'm not coming back home. But this woman, she didn't run. She stood up there and she spoke to him and she said, "My father, you have given your word to God. Do to me as you promised God." That equals faith. Faith. She believed in God that she will or may be delivered through him, just like Isaac. Remember the story of Abraham and Isaac? I'm sure that came to her mind. If her father knew his Bible well, the daughter probably did. And she too thought and said, "Oh my God, maybe God will save me. Do to me as you have promised." And then she told him, as you see in the picture, "But please give me a couple of months to roam the hills and weep with my friends, because I will never marry." And she bewailed her virginity. And I put this question here before you. What really happened to Jephthah's daughter? People talk a lot. Some people say she was really given as a sacrifice. Other Bible scholars, and I've done a lot of reading before I come to talk here today, said that no, he made a stupid vow, he made a sinful vow, he made a wrong vow, and he retracted. And in turn, he gave something to God. Indeed, you know, God is not and will never be pleased with human sacrifices. Now, as I said, if you have to sacrifice your daughter, you have to give it to the priests. What kind of priest would have burned an alive young woman as a sacrifice to God? It just does not make sense. God really, in all honesty, doesn't like these kind of vows at all. Look, in Deuteronomy, we read this verse, "Don't be like bad people. They burn their sons and daughters in the fire as a sacrifice to God." God is never happy and never pleased with a human sacrifice. And another thing, as we said in the back room, she bewailed her virginity. Really, would you have been bewailing your virginity if you're going to die? Things for us all to think about. And here I've just given you the long text in Leviticus 5 that you can retract. I will close by these coming slides. Number one, lessons to learn from Jephthah's stupid, sinful vow. Number one, Proverbs. It is a trap to dedicate something rationally. Rationally means what? Quickly. And only later to consider what you have done. It is a trap. Don't be rushed. Don't rush into a vow. Don't promise to God or to people. Do not promise. If you promise, you have to keep your vow. So So be sure what you promise is something that you can do. Think it over once, twice, and three times. Don't rush into vow. Number two, the book of Ecclesiastes. Look what Solomon says. Do not be quick with your mouth, and do not be hasty in your heart to utter anything before God. When you make a vow to God, do not delay to fulfill it. And as we heard in the back room, it is better not to make a vow than to make a vow and not fulfill it. My prayer is that any one of us today who has made a vow before God and has not fulfilled it, even years after, that may God give us strength to fulfill the vow. Last thing we can learn from Jephthah's vow is in the book of Numbers. When a man makes a vow to God or takes an oath to obligate himself by pledge, he must not break his word, but must do everything you say. And here I'm just reminding you of what we studied in Deuteronomy a year ago. If you make a vow to God, do not be slow to pay it, for the Lord will certainly demand it before you. Whatever your lips utter, you must be sure to do, because you made your vow free. Last slide. Lessons to learn from the girl, not from her father, from Jephthah's daughter herself. Number one, faithfulness to God comes before the family. This woman, she said to her father, if you vow to God, even if it's going to come on my head and I will lose my life, as long as we promise to God, God comes first, before the family. And there's so many things in the Bible to teach that Jesus said that if you leave father, if you love your family member more than me, you do not deserve. Faithfulness and love to God comes before the family. You can think of this in so many ways. Put God first and your family second. But the same God who's asking you to put him first is the same God who said, I want mercy and not sacrifice. So be merciful to the people around you. Number two, it teaches all young youth and children that children should obey their parents. This woman obeyed her father, although it was a hurtful decision, but she was obedient. Obey your parents. Good. Number three. Her friends went with her to weep and to mourn. Lesson to learn. We as a church, you as an individual, your family as a family, learn to weep with those who weep. And to rejoice with those who rejoice. Important. Weep with those who weep. Oh, how many times I knew there were funerals and people that were mourning and I failed to come. It's easy to rejoice with those who rejoice, but to weep with people who weep is hard, but it is requested of you and me. Reach out to people who are sorrowful and are hurting. Show them your compassion. And show them that you care for them and you feel their pain. Last but not least, we must remember people who sacrificed. You know, the Bible says from this comes the Israelite custom. They have a custom in Israel that every year young women of Israel go out for 4 days to commemorate the death of the daughter of Jephthah. And that's why our church also commemorates the martyrs. And we think of them. We must remember people who've sacrificed for us. Chapter 12 is a short chapter. It talks about a fight that took place between Jephthah the Gileadite and the people of Ephraim. The people of Ephraim are always a problem. I don't know if you remember two or three Fridays back, Gideon had a problem with them as well. They came to him after he won the war. You would expect them to come to Gideon and say, "Thank you, you've relieved us from oppression." But instead they told him arrogantly, "Why did you do it yourself? Why didn't you come and ask us for help?" And do you remember how Gideon answered? And Gideon answered them very nicely. And we talked about this verse, that the gentle answer turns away wrath. But with Jephthah, when they came and gave him the same problem, they told him, "How did you do it on your own? Why didn't you call us to come?" Jephthah did not follow the first part of the verse. He actually taught me the second part of the verse, that a harsh answer will stir up anger. And there was anger between them, and they fought together. Tonight, tomorrow, when you hear a hard answer, a harsh word from your colleague at work, from a friend at the church, from your spouse, from a child, be gentle in your response and remember the verse of Solomon. And yes, they fought together, Jephthah and his people from Israel, and Ephraim and the people from Israel. They both fought together. And we do the same in the church. We are the same church and we fight together. Leader and another leader fight together. A meeting and another meeting, they fight together. A Bible study and another Bible study, they fight together. Who wants to be better? A church and another church, they fight together. Who wants to be better? Who is right and who is wrong? A denomination and another denomination, they fight together. And it's all, nothing is new. Human nature is still the same. There is no humbleness, there is no meekness, there is no love, and there is no forgiveness. And the people of Jephthah wanted to make sure they killed all the Ephraimites, all of them. The way they did that is something very interesting. They took them all, and they killed them as much as they could, and then they went to the forks of the river. You know what a fork of a river is? The ford of a river? I'll tell you what it is. The river Jordan. They went to the ford. The ford of a river is the part of a river that has very shallow water. And so you can what? Cross and escape. Run. And then they will catch a person who's trying to run, and they will tell him this: "Can you please say the word that shibboleth? Shibboleth. And it's just, so that's very good. The word shibboleth, I looked it up, it means a flood. The word means flood. The people of Ephraim could not say shh. They couldn't say, they said s. So they would say shibboleth. If they said s, that's what the Bible says. If they say shibboleth, they are good, they will die. But if they said shibboleth, because they could not pronounce the word correctly, they seized them and they killed them at the fords of the river Jordan. It's a story here. Shibboleth. Remember that word, shibboleth. Just like cha, cha. We can say cha, those coming from the Middle East. But people here in North America, they cannot say the word cha. It is a difficult way to say it. And the Bible says that Jephthah led Israel for 6 years. Then Jephthah, the Gileadite, died. And he was buried in Gilead. He died. Jephthah died. Everyone will die. We don't want to remember that, but it is important to remember this fact of life, that we are going to go down. And we will give account of what we have done. Try to live the heavenly life here on earth. before the time goes. Plan about your life in heaven. We plan about our trips in the summer and our vacations, our airplane tickets, the hotels, but we need, and I need, and you need to plan about your heavenly life. How much investment do you put in this life that is to come? We all prophesy that we're true Christians, and that we believe in the afterlife, and we believe in the second coming of the Messiah, and that He will take us up to heaven. Yet, all our investment, and our time, and our energy, and our thoughts is here on a world that will go. We will not take nothing with us. What will you can't take with you is love. When you love me and you love the person you live with and you love your neighbor like yourself, that you can take with you. God will say, yes, you have been my disciple. They will know that we are Christians by our love. Forgive people. Don't judge. All this will come to have a relationship with the saints of the church, with the angels. They are real. The saints that we believe in are alive. They are not dead. They are alive. Our Father is a Father of alive people.
Hosanna Bible Study Group meets every Friday, 7:30 p.m. till 9:30 p.m. at SMSV Church, 3300 Highway 7 East, Markham. The website is hosannabiblestudy.com, where you can sign up for weekly emails and you will get emails about upcoming lecture and the questions and everything else.